Greetings and God's blessings to you this fourth and last Sunday in Advent. The Old Testament lesson from the book of Micah, chapter 5, verses 2 to 5. The epistle from the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 10, verses 5 to 10. And the Holy Gospel, the account of the visitation of Mary to her relative Elizabeth, from Luke chapter 1, verses 39 to 45. What we'll look at today is the epistle lesson, Hebrews chapter 10, and I'll read verses 8 to 10 in Jesus' name. When he, that is, Christ, said above, "You have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings," then in parentheses, "these are offered according to the law." Then he added, "Behold, I have come to do your will." He abolishes the first in order to establish the second. And by that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Heavenly Father, these are your words, and therefore they are the truth. We ask you to sanctify us by this truth. Amen. He had plenty of time for thinking. No one was around to interrupt his thoughts. No one gave him anything. The pigs he fed were not interested in what was on his mind, how he had squandered his father's property in reckless living and spent everything, only to find himself caught in a famine, his hunger so severe that he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate. But reason had returned to him. He had sinned against his father. He had sinned against God. The only reasonable solution was to go back home, confess his sin, and atone for his sin through sacrifice. He would become his father's slave. "I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants." How many times did he rehearse those lines as he staggered home? How many years of slavery did he expect to endure? How many sacrifices did he expect to make? Today, the writer to the Hebrews reminds us why our Lord's advent is so important. Jesus comes to break the cycles of sacrifice. He breaks them through his body and in his body. The first three candles of the Advent wreath represent peace, hope, and joy. These are not just fleeting emotions that depend on the kind of day we're having, but real blessings that we treasure in our hearts regardless of circumstance. As we make our way around the wreath, we move closer to the source of these blessings, the fourth candle, which symbolizes the love of God our Father, and of course, the candle in the middle, the tall white one, the picture of Christ in our midst. The message is clear. Without the Father's love, which he reveals to us in his Son, we have no peace or hope or joy. If you've already read the scripture lessons, you'll notice they reinforce this message. In the Old Testament lesson, Micah proclaims good news of peace and hope for the little town of Bethlehem. In the Gospel lesson, there is good news of great joy in Zechariah's house and in Elizabeth's womb. The Epistle lesson brings us back to the source of the good news. If you read the whole Epistle lesson, you saw that the first half of the text is a quote from Jesus himself, spoken, as the writer puts it, when Christ came into the world. But you won't find those words anywhere in the Gospels. You have to go back to Psalm 40 to find them. And when you go back to Psalm 40, you'll see that David was the author. But here in Hebrews, the Holy Spirit makes it clear that these verses were spoken by Christ himself. This should not surprise us. There was never a time when the Son of God did not exist. He said above, "You," that is, God the Father, "have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings." Now this might surprise us. God never desired sacrifices? He didn't like them? Could have fooled me. What about a book like Leviticus with all these detailed instructions for sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings? If God never wanted any of those things, It's a bit odd that he spent so much energy on them. Well, just because God commanded sacrifices doesn't mean he wanted them. They were not necessarily a reflection of his will. For all the laws in a book like Leviticus, let's not forget that Genesis came first. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth in perfect holiness. His desire was that we live at peace with him and in harmony with one another. It was not his will that we should give in to temptation and disobey him. Nor does he take any pleasure in the ways we try to cover up or cover over our sin. The candles of the Advent wreath remind us that by nature, we are people walking in darkness, not only in the darkness of sin, but also in the darkness of what our reason calls atonement for sin. I recognize my sin. I see the darkness. The only reasonable solution must be found in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings, offering all that I have, including my body and life, in hope that someone will give me something for my trouble, a crust, a crumb, a pot of pity. Whoever you are, make me your slave, but take this burden of guilt away. This is our reasonable solution to the problem of sin, and it is the reason for so many problems today. It is the fundamental cause of every kind of suicide, the quick kind and the slow kind. Suicide of the body, the mind, and the soul. As sinners lost in darkness, searching for a flicker of life, find themselves caught in these cycles of sacrifice and end up working themselves to death. The lost son had his thoughts in order. His lines were well rehearsed. But his father interrupted him. While he was still a long way off, his father saw him and ran and embraced him and kissed him. He tried to say his lines, but Dad wouldn't let him finish. The father said to his servants, "Bring quickly the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring the fattened calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate." That day it was not the son's reasonable solution, but the father's loving will that prevailed. You have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings. These are offered according to the law. I personally realize now that one of the reasons God established those laws, all those details about the sacrifices, was to keep his people safe, to keep them from killing themselves and their families while trying to atone for their sin. At the same time, those sacrifices and offerings looked forward to the advent of his son. For when he came into the world, then he added, "Behold, I have come to do your will." Jesus comes to break the cycles of sacrifice. It says in Hebrews, he abolishes the first. This word to abolish something, means to take it up and do away with it. We just sang, we'll sing before the sermon tomorrow, "A Lamb Goes Uncomplaining Forth," which is a Lenten hymn. It seems out of place for this time of year. But a hymn like that helps us understand this, so we don't lose sight of it. Jesus took up those sacrifices and offerings and did away with all of them by taking up the cross and sacrificing himself for our sin, offering up his perfect life and innocent death to God for our redemption. He abolishes the first and rises from the dead in order to establish the second, a new testament of the Father's true desire, which is to love us and give us eternal life, to forgive our sins for the sake of his Son's atoning sacrifice. This is our Father's good and gracious will. And by that will, it says, we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ, once for all. We've been sanctified through it. Here we see the work of the Holy Spirit in the Word and sacraments. In baptism, the offering of Jesus Christ comes to us. The old sinful life is abolished. It is taken up and done away with. And we are born again of the Father's love. This blessing, And all the blessings of hope and peace and joy that come with it is confirmed in us, established more deeply in our hearts through the Holy Supper. There we hear the words of Christ himself. He speaks of the offering of his body and the shedding of his blood as the one atoning sacrifice for our sins. And those precious gifts are truly present right there in our hands. There is no need for more sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings. They do not need to be taken up again. This has a very practical effect on our lives. For one thing, it frees up our schedule. My daily agenda doesn't include slaughtering animals. Your daily agenda doesn't include picking them out from your flocks and herds and bringing them to me. That's all been abolished. Through the body of Christ, you and I have been brought into the body of Christ, into his church, where we are sanctified, set apart, and set free for a new cycle of, well, of what exactly? When he was asked for advice, John the Baptist never spoke of burnt offerings or sin offerings. He spoke of repentance of heart and life, and pointed to the Lamb of God and his atoning sacrifice. Jesus himself never told anyone to bring him an animal to be killed. One day Jesus listened to a scribe describe the meaning of God's law. To love God with all the heart and with all the understanding and with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself, is much more than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. In reply, Jesus didn't say, "Actually, that's not true. You still need the burnt offerings and sacrifices." No, Jesus said, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." When we think of what people actually brought to Jesus, or what they offered him, we might think about the wise men and their gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Those are nice gifts, but there were others too. People brought Jesus the sick, the leprous, the blind, the lame, the demon-possessed. Mothers brought him their little children. Jesus received them all, both the bitter and the sweet. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Our risen Savior is still willing to do that for us. He lives and reigns. He stands and shepherds his flock. He cares for his body. He invites us to bring him our children to be baptized into his name. He invites us to bring him our sins and sorrows and trust that his Father will forgive us for the sake of his atoning sacrifice. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. By faith in Jesus' body and blood, we can be confident that we stand before God and will stand before God holy and blameless. Until that day comes, we offer ourselves to do our Father's will. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, dear Father. Now that your will has been done through your Son's body, may it be done in his body too. Jesus offered his body once for all, not only for all of us, but for all people. He abolishes the first in order to establish the second in the heart of every sinner. Go back to the parable of the prodigal son or the lost son. Remember that there was another lost son, the older one. Dad had to come out to him too because the killing of the fattened calf for his younger brother wasn't sitting right with him. He said to his father, "Look, these many years I have served you, and I never disobeyed your command, yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends." In other words, someone should be offering me sacrifices. With that malicious pride in his heart, can there be any doubt that he would have agreed with his brother's solution of slavery for life? Can there be any doubt that he would have kept his brother enslaved even after their father was dead? That can't be the way we treat a brother or neighbor who has offended us. The new cycle must rule in our relationships, not only with one another, but with our neighbors too. It is God's will that the blessings our church has received as a gift be shared as a gift. By grace, through faith, we have been brought to know the Father's love and find eternal life in His Son's sacrifice for our sins. We have good news that breaks the cycle of death and destruction. We have been set free to proclaim it. We have the candles. If we indeed have been set free by the Son of God, then let us rejoice and let our light shine before men. No more let sins and sorrows grow. Jesus comes to make His blessings known far as the curse is found. The cycles of sacrifice have been broken. Repeat the sounding joy. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.